Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Rajiv Jain from Jivaji University, Gwalior. Today we are going to discuss the module on electroanalytical chemistry part 2 under the paper Fundamentals of Analytical Chemistry. Learning objectives in this lecture will be about electroanalytical techniques. You already know that electroanalytical techniques are concerned with the transfer of electrons from one place to another. This place is usually electrodes to the electroactive species. Electroactive species is that species which can accept the electron or give the electron. So in this module today, we shall study controlled potential electrolysis, which may be carried out by controlling the potential or controlling the current. And then we shall study here coulometry, which has number of advantages by finding out coulombs. And then we shall study here one of the examples of voltammetry techniques, in which we take dropping mercury electrode instead of a solid electrode, and that is called as polarography. Here we shall study all these three techniques one by one. For potentiometry, you have seen the cell is not allowed to operate. With zero current, it is assumed that the electrode is in equilibrium with the solution and that concentrations do not change with time. Such cells, however, possess an EMF whether or not they are operating and are sources of electrical energy if the circuit is completed and current allowed to flow. With a finite current, the concentration must change as the cell reaction proceeds. The EMF gradually approaches zero as the concentrations approach the equilibrium state. Now let us add another component to the circuit. If applied is greater than E cell, that is, applied potential is greater than the cell potential, then the current is reversed. Likewise, the cell reaction is reversed from its normal spontaneous direction. If E applied is continuously adjusted to maintain a constant current, and if conditions are such that only a single electrode reaction takes place at the electrode and the efficiency is 100% current efficiency, then it is not necessary to weigh the electrode, as in the case of electrogravimetry. In electrogravimetry, we take the weight of the electrode and we deposit the substance on the electrode, then we take the energy weight. So here, if the current efficiency is 100%, then it is not necessary to take the weight of the electrode. The amount of the reaction can be readily determined from Faraday's law, that is, F into equivalent reacted is equal to I into T, where T is the time in second and F is the number of coulombs per equivalent, that is 96,493, or it is called as Faraday's constant. As we have seen that in the electrolysis of copper, the cathode potential must be made more negative with time in order to continue the reaction of copper ion. Concurrently, the hydrogen ion concentration is increasing and eventually cathode potential will be sufficiently negative to reduce hydrogen ion as well as copper ion. This is a typical situation, that is to say, it is rarely possible to maintain a single electrode reaction. The method as such finds little use, but it is the basis for coulometric titrations, which will be described here in detail. If a third electrode, called as auxiliary reference electrode, is placed within the electrolysis cell and connected through a voltage measuring device, then the potential of either one of the working electrodes can be monitored as shown in figure. The E applied is then adjusted throughout the electrolysis to maintain a constant cathode or anode potential. In this way, we can be sure that only a single reaction is taking place and that the number of coulombs passed is directly related to the substance to be determined. However, the current decreases with time and approaches zero gradually. Therefore, equation 1 must be modified and we obtain after integrating equation 1, equation 2 is obtained. In addition to analytical applications, controlled potential electrolysis is useful in identifying reaction products and the number of electrons taking part in a reaction. The method also serves as a preparative tool. The electrode acts as an oxidant, a reductant with constant known value of anyone desires. Some preparations for which no suitable agents are available can be easily carried out. In above discussion, we have seen that with controlled cathode or controlled anode potential electrolysis, it is easy to maintain a single electrode reaction or 100% current efficiency. However, the current necessarily decreases with time in a logarithmic fashion so that the area under the curve I versus T must be found by integration. Constant current electrolysis allows an easy determination of coulombs, but since the electrode potential necessarily changes with time, other electrode reactions may occur. Therefore, we cannot maintain 100% current efficiency with respect to the desired reaction. If the current is kept constant, the extent of reaction is directly proportional to the time of electrolysis, but the electrode potential must increase and another reaction will eventually take over. On the other hand, if the potential is kept constant, only the desired reaction will occur, but the rate of reaction will decrease exponentially. The advantages of both these techniques are neatly combined in a secondary coulometric titration. In this method, the substance to be determined is indirectly titrated with a reagent, that is, electrolytically generated in situ. A typical coulometric titration apparatus includes a titration beaker and two independent circuits as shown in figure 2. The generator circuit requires a source of constant current and a pair of electrodes, one of which generates the titrate and the other of which is separated from the solution by a fritted glass connection. For precision and convenience, the switch controlling the current source also controls a timer. The detector circuit requires a suitable indicator electrode, reference electrode, and potentiometer. The signal from the potentiometer can be used to stop the titration and the timer. For repetitive determinations, the timer can be calibrated in grams, equivalents, or even percent composition of a particular weight of sample. Many types of titrants normally used in volumetric analysis can be generated with 100% current efficiency at an electrode. These include oxidants, reductants, acids, bases, precipitants, complexing agents, and several metal ions. There is no need to prepare or store standard solutions. Thus, chlorine and chromous ions are as easy to use as sodium chloride. Chemical primary standards are replaced by electrical measurements. Or stated another way, the electron becomes the universal primary standard. Small currents and short times can be measured accurately. In principle, the accuracy is limited by the uncertainty in the value of the Faraday. In practice, the accuracy is limited by the reproducibility of the endpoint. Acid-based titrations are readily performed by coulometry. Both acids and base can be generated either internally within the solution or externally as shown in the following figure. The external apparatus is particularly convenient for generating small amounts of carbonate-free base as needed. Similarly, a large number of organic compounds react with the halogens that are easily generated from the corresponding halide at a platinum electrode. The determinations of 8-hydroxyquinoline with electrolytically generated bromine and the bromine number of unsaturated compounds are some of the examples. The determination of traces of pesticide residues in foods is a difficult but important analytical problem. The sensitivity of most analytical methods is not adequate, and even with the best gas chromatographs, an ultra-sensitive specific detector is required. Many common pesticides contain chlorine or sulfur, which are readily converted to HCl and H2S reactions built into the end of the chromatographic column. After selective absorption of these gases in an electrolytic cell, the coulometric titrator with electrolytic generation of silver ion is an ideal detector for this complicated problem. Some of the advantages of coulometric titrations can be summarized in short as: small amounts of substances can be determined accurately. No standard solutions are required. Unstable intermediates can be used as titrants, which is a very important thing, which is not possible in other techniques, which can be done very easily by coulometric titrations. The apparatus required is inexpensive and easily automated. The technique in which one of the working electrodes, that is the working electrode or indicator electrode, is replaced by a micro electrode of mercury called as dropping mercury electrode. The technique is known as polarography. It is very early technique. It was given by Hirovsky in 1922, for which he was awarded Nobel Prize in 1959. What is polarography? Any voltammetric technique in which mercury electrode is used is called as polarographic technique. It is a group of techniques. It includes pulse polarography, differential pulse polarography, Tast polarography, oscillation polarography, different AC polarography. All polarography techniques are those techniques which contains dropping mercury electrode or hanging mercury dropping electrode or static mercury electrode. They are called as polarographic techniques. What happens in these techniques? One of the electrode is reference electrode, which may be calomel electrode, and another electrode is a dropping mercury electrode, which is a polarizable electrode at which we apply the potential and we observe the change in current. Here, the electroactive species reach the electrode surface by the process of diffusion. It is very important to understand the diffusion. Diffusion process is that when a substance is, when an electroactive species is present in the solution, and under the influence, solution structure may be divided into two parts, a bulk solution and a part which is in the close vicinity of the electrode surface. When certain potential is applied, the species which is in close vicinity of the electrode, it gets reduced or oxidized. Now, due to the lesser amount of that species at the electrode surface, some of the substance, some of the analyte, get transferred or get diffused from the bulk solution to the electrode surface. Means a concentration gradient is developed and species is diffusing from more concentration to lower concentration or from the bulk of the solution to the surface of the electrode surface, means a concentration gradient has established and current gradually increases, and at a certain point there is a limiting value. Why it is limiting value? Because the rate of diffusion is equal to the rate of reduction or rate of oxidation at the electrode surface. And this process is, and this is the principle of holography, which is based upon Ilkovic equation given by Ilkovic, that is ID is equal to 607 NC D0 half M2 by 3 T1 by 6, that, and if we take all this constant, then ID is proportional to concentration. We can find out the concentration of unknown substance by measuring the current. ID is diffusion current, because current is directly proportional to the concentration. This all we study in holography. Applications of holography are limited to those species that can be oxidized or reduced at dropping mercury electrode. The potential region is limited in the positive direction by the oxidation of the electrode material itself, that is about 0.4 volt for mercury, and in the negative direction by the reduction of the supporting electrolyte or the solvent, which is about minus 2.0 volt for KCl in water. Or we can say that holography can be applied to each and every substance which can be oxidized or reduced, but it is limited to the positive direction, where its potential window is only up to 0.4 volt, because after that electrode itself, that is mercury itself, oxidizes and current adds to the current of the analyte. So one of the limitations of holography, that in positive range or in oxidations or anodically, we cannot study most of the substances. But on the negative side, that is cathodically, we can study most of the substances by holographic techniques. A platinum microelectrode will extend the anodic range to about 1.0 volt, and the use of non-aqueous solvents and organic salts, typically quaternary ammonium salts, as supporting electrolyte, can extend the cathodic range to minus 2.5 volt. But if we take the platinum microelectrode as the anode, then the character of holography changes, then it comes under the category of voltammetry. The optimum concentration range is 10 raised to power minus 2 to 10 raised to power 5 molar solution. The upper limit is set by the need for a 100 fold excess of supporting electrolyte, and the lower limit is set by the magnitude of the residual current, which should not exceed the diffusion current. A special instrumentation is available to compensate for the residual current and allow determinations as low as 10 raised to power minus 7 molar solutions. Most of the metal ions and many inorganic anions are readily determined alone or in mixtures. Several classes of organic compounds can be easily determined by holographic techniques. Organic compounds include conjugated double bonds, extended aromatic ring systems, halogen compounds, carbonyls, quinones, dicarboxylic acids, keto acids, as well as many organic compounds which contain carbon nitrogen, nitrogen nitrogen, nitrogen oxygen, oxygen oxygen, sulfur sulfur, and carbon sulfur bonds. Because of the reproducibility of the dropping mercury electrode, and each time we get a new drop, and due to the ease of acquiring data, holographic techniques are valuable for studying fundamental electrode processes. Holographic techniques can also be used for studying the thermodynamics and kinetics of the reaction. There are many variations in the electrodes and circuits that are described in many advanced and specialized textbooks. If we take some modifications of the holographic technique to increase the sensitivity of the technique, we may consider a complete hologram which may be obtained during the lifetime of a single drop by making a rapid scan of the applied voltage scan using an electronic ramp generator. The peak shapes are distorted from the usual waves because the diffusion process is unable to supply reducible material to the electrode surface to satisfy the rapidly increasing potential. So, in case of another modification, which is known as differential or pulse holography, pulse holographic, normal pulse holographic technique, and differential pulse holographic technique, where we apply the pulse of the potential. In case of holography, we apply potential throughout the life of the drop. But in pulse holography, for increasing the sensitivity of the technique, we apply a pulse of the potential so that the residual current decreases and the sensitivity increases, and we can measure it. In case of differential pulse holography, sensitivity increases up to 10⁻⁸ molar solutions. In another related technique, which is extensively used for determination of reaction mechanism of different types of organic compounds, coordinated complex, various types of reaction, elucidation of the structure of different types of organic compound, is cyclic voltammetry. In cyclic voltammetry, a triangular shaped voltage is applied during the last second or so before the drop falls. This gives a complete scan forward and backward so that the products of reaction can be reoxidized before they can diffuse away from the electrode surface. Thus, a convenient way of studying the degree of reversibility of electrode reactions. The slowly increasing ramp voltage can be modulated by superimposing a small alternating potential of a few millivolts. This leads to an AC component of the current that reaches a maximum at the halfway potential. AC holography makes it easier to resolve overlapping waves. In order to eliminate the effect of the residual current, the ramp voltage may be modulated with a small square wave. During each pulse, the residual current dies out quickly and the current is measured only at the end of the pulse. Other types of pulses have been used to increase resolvability and for studies of electrode kinetics. Another very important and modern method, which is a modification of electroanalytical technique, is a two-step method called as stripping analysis, which is useful for analysis of trace quantities of different types of substances. In the first step, metals, for example, if we take metals are concentrated by cathodic deposition at a solid microelectrode or on a single hanging mercury droplet. In the second step, the applied voltage is reversed and the metals are determined by a reverse, that is the anodic process, holographic or coulometric analysis. Typical procedure includes a pre-electrolysis for about 1 minute, which is sufficient to reduce nearly all of the metal ions in the entire sample. This greatly increases the sensitivity over conventional holography, in which only a negligible amount of the sample is actually used. So, in this stripping voltammetry, which may be cathodic stripping voltammetry or anodic stripping voltammetry, it is a two-way process. First, analyte is deposited on the electrode surface, but current is not measured. In the second step, the analyte is stripped off from the electrode surface and it goes to the solution and current is measured. And this is the most sensitive technique available in the hands of the chemist, and the sensitivity matches with the atomic absorption spectroscopy. And here we can go up to 10⁻¹⁰ molar solutions, and we can Students, you have learned in this lecture how electron transfer can be utilized for finding out the concentration of unknown solution, how electrolytic techniques can be utilized for qualitative as well as quantitative analysis. What is qualitative parameter of analysis in electrolytic techniques? It is potential. It may be halfway potential as in polarography, or E as in control potential electrolysis, coulometry, Q. So amount of current we measure. So it is the potential means what is the energy parameter in electrolytic technique is the potential. So potential is the qualitative parameter of analysis, means by finding out the potential of unknown substance, we can identify that substance. By a single experiment, as you have seen here, we can identify three or four substances by a single experiment. We can identify, for example, copper, cadmium, nickel, zinc by a single experiment simultaneously, qualitatively, as well as quantitatively. What is the quantitative parameter of analysis? In electrochemical techniques, in polarography, in voltammetry, it is current. The current, with concentration, current increases and it is directly proportional to the concentration of the substance. By plotting a calibration curve, we may find out the concentration of unknown substance. In another technique which you studied is controlled potential electrolysis, means or controlled electrolysis, which may be carried out at controlled potential, at constant potential, or at constant current. And that can be utilized for finding out number of electrons involved in the electrode process, for finding out or identifying the end product. We may use controlled potential electrolysis or controlled current electrolysis. Then we studied coulometry, coulombs, measurement of coulombs here, and it is based upon directly Faraday laws of electrolysis. We here in controlled potential electrolysis or in coulometric analysis, we may also find out the number of electrons involved in. The determination of number of electrons is very important while writing the reaction mechanism, or while finding out the unusual oxidation states of the different metal ions. For finding out intermediate, another very important technique is the cyclic voltammetry, where we can find out the products which has been formed as an intermediate for fraction of seconds, that we can determine with the help of cyclic voltammetry. Here what we do, we apply a predetermined potential, then in the reverse cycle we study the intermediate involved therein. So overall, by using different types of electroanalytic techniques, as we have studied here in this lecture, we have studied controlled electrolysis involving constant potential or constant current, and then using microelectrode of mercury, polarography, and then coulometry we all in combination can be used for elucidation the reaction mechanism of a compound, for finding out the stability constants of different types of coordination complexes, for finding out the intermediate, as well as for qualitative and quantitative analysis, along with studying the rate of reaction, means studying the kinetics and thermodynamics of the system. Thank you.